Hello, I'm Dave, and look, book background. Yeah, I'm a proper vlogger now. I look pretty intellectual, don't I, in my little book corner?
No, I don't. That's a myth. You don't need these to be clever. We live in an age of unprecedented literacy. Today, almost all of the main methods of communication between teenagers are text-based. When I was younger, I was unusually literate. I started school already able to fluently read and fairly fluently write. And yet in all that time when I was at school being literate, writing letters to people was a really unusual thing for us to do. I can probably remember every letter I wrote to anyone. It only happened 3 or 4 times ever, and that was for a really literate kid. If we include text messages, Facebook PMs and the like as writing letters to each other, and honestly, why wouldn't we? It's just snobbery if we do.
Don't. If we don't, I'm end, of course. Shush.
Then you'd be hard-pressed to find a teenager today who hasn't written a letter to another teenager. In fact, you'd be hard-pressed to find one who hasn't written several letters that day. That is a world that's engaging with reading and writing on a level we never have before. So how come, if we're all able to read and write to that level, we don't all read books all the time? We can tell each other about how intellectual books are, but most books you'll ever read are entertainment. Almost everything you can see on my shelves are primarily a source of entertainment, and yes, some of them make you cleverer along the way, but then so do some DVDs, and so do some games. We have a lot of time to put into entertainment. You know someone who's watched the entirety of Breaking Bad multiple times. You might be someone who's done that. So how come so many times, if you say to someone, "Read any good books lately?" No one says that in real life, but if they did, "Read any good books lately?" They go, "Huh?" And you go, "Have you read, what books are you reading? What, have you read any books recently? What books?" And they go, "I don't really read books." And you go, "You know, what do you mean?" "Well, I haven't got time. Where would I get the time to read a book?"
And suddenly you feel as if you were being all high and mighty by asking the question in the first place.
"Ooh, you've got to read books because that's what I do."
But you didn't mean it like that. You just wanted to know if they'd been entertained by something recently. Same as saying, "What have you been watching on telly? What games have you been playing?" Well, there are lots of us who are just as into reading books as we are into watching telly or playing games or whatever it happens to be. So I thought, why on earth shouldn't I start telling you about the ones I've been reading? I did that after Christmas. I did a quick video about John Green's The Fault in Our Stars and A.A. Milne's The Red House Mystery, and you seemed to actually really like that, so I thought I might as well just carry on then, really, mightn't I?
Let's start with the common ground that we all have. Look at any nerd's bookshelf in any YouTube video and you'll see two series sitting there that always look exactly the same. You recognise them straight away. One of them is Harry Potter, and the other one is Discworld. You all know these books very well. They adorn your shelves, they adorn your friends' shelves, and perhaps you've even read them, but I hadn't. See, I've spent most of my life as a kind of proto-fan of Discworld. I've always known that I was going to love these books, but I've never quite been able to broach them and read them, and I'm going to tell you today about why that is. Now, I've always been a Pratchett fan. It's nothing to do with him. I suppose I have to assume that some of you haven't read these books and don't know what they are. So, Terry Pratchett, he is a man with a beard and a hat, and he writes stories about magic things. One of the things he writes is children's books, and that's how I was introduced to him. When I read Truckers, or rather when my mum read Truckers to me, I was a fan. Immediately. That's a great book. And I don't have it here. It must still be at mum and dad's house. So, aha. Here we are, this'll do. So, Truckers was adapted for TV not long after I read the book. In something of a golden age of UK children's television, need I say much more than Maid Marian was in full swing at the time. Look at that! Oh, lovely, lovely, lovely old video. Truckers is one of Pratchett's first, actually it might be his first, children's book. I'm not sure. When did The Carpet People come out? Don't know. Anyway, it's one of his first children's books, and it's about gnomes. Look at them. Actually, if you can find this, it's really worth having a look at. It's on YouTube, or get the video like it. It's not out on DVD. Believe me, I tried. I was gonna buy it and everything. But anyway, the TV series is actually really accurate to the book, so knock yourself out if you can't be bothered reading the book. But read the book. Just read the book. And it's about these gnomes who live out in the wild, and they discover that there is this superstore called Arnold Brothers, established 1905. They go there, and they discover that underneath it and in the walls live these great tribes, this whole civilization of gnomes. But they've never been outside the store. And in fact, they don't think there is one. Because did not Arnold Brothers est 1905, right,
all things under one roof. Therefore there can be no outside. Therefore you people are not from it.
But we really do come from outside.
There is no outside!
And so their whole culture is entirely based around the advertising slogans of the people who've set up this store. And if that sounds sort of twee and silly to you, you don't know Pratchett yet, and you don't know why it was that I latched onto him and so many other people did. Because yes, it is twee and silly, it is. But he'll take a silly idea, and he'll write a book about it that's actually quite affecting. And this is particularly true of his children's books. He's one of those secret, brilliant children's writers. I really think he's one of the best children's authors there is. I think he's a better children's author than he is adult author, even though it's in the adult sphere that his, you know, that's where his niche is. And it's possible that a lot of his readers haven't read Truckers or Nation or Only You Can Save Mankind, and they think that he's one kind of brilliant writer, and they don't realise he's actually another kind as well, and that one's absolutely brilliant. He's built this actual culture that lives there, and you know, some of them are funny, and some of them are deeply sad. There's this dying abbot who spent his whole life and career devoted to this god called Arnold Brothers. The gnomes from the outside bring with them a relic of their past that they don't know what it is. It's just a little square box, but it starts to change everything and teach them all about what's really going on and where they are really from. And what could have been just jokes, and the jokes are in there, you know, their devil character is called Prices Slashed. When they're surprised, they go, bargains galore! But instead of just being about those jokes, instead you get this story that's actually about insular cultures and closed-mindedness and fundamentalism, and it's a really good book. So I wanted to get into Discworld. My dad read all the Discworld books, I think my mum read all the Discworld books. They were on my periphery the whole time, and I knew I was going to like them. And then I got the PC game. I liked that as well. I couldn't really do anything in it or play it particularly because it was extremely complicated and hard. Either it's hard or the puzzles just don't make any sense. But I loved it. It was pretty and it was beautiful, and the whole setup, you've got this wizard guy, Rincewind, you've got the luggage, you've got all these characters, and of course you've got death. So I always knew I was going to like Discworld when I finally got round to reading the actual books. And I tried, and I failed, because there's a barrier to entry with Discworld. Or at least I'd been taken in with the fiction that there is a barrier to entry with Discworld, and that's what I'm here to talk to you about in my book corner today. Tell a seasoned Discworld fan that you're thinking of getting into the books, and likely as not, their response is going to be something like this. They'll recline back in whatever comfortable chair they happen to be sitting in, they'll take a long and thoughtful sip of a cup of tea, because no Discworld fan is ever really very far removed from a cup of tea, and they'll say... And they'll say, where are you starting? And you'll say, what? And they'll say, well, where are you going to start reading the books? Which order are you going to read them in? What decisions have you made during your research about where to start reading the books? And you go, well, book one? And they go, no, you don't have to do that. You can do them in any order. It's fine. There's a... Because the thing about Discworld is, the way it works, is that it's divided into these little series, right? So there's the wizards, and there's the witches, and there's the watch. They're the best ones. And there's death, and there's all these ones. So what you can do is you can, like, pick a series, and you can read that, and you can start from anywhere, really. I mean, Reaper Man, that's probably the best one. You want to start there, really, because that's the best... I mean, there's all these different ways, because what you could do... Because the thing is... But book one, I was thinking maybe I'd start book one. No, you don't, because the thing is about the first... See, the first couple of books, for a while, it's not quite... It doesn't really hit its stride. Because the tone is very... It hasn't quite really settled into... the characters, because they come in, obviously, like, quite early on. They're all there, but they sort of develop, and so by the time you get to, like, Pratchett doesn't even like the first... The thing is... So you go, oof, this is starting to sound like a bit of an undertaking. Where do you think I should start? Well, start with Reaper Man, of course, obviously. Guards is another good one. That's the Watch. They're really good. Oh, they're fine. Brilliant. Maybe for someone who's just starting off, it might be better to, and before you know it, you've been talked into reading their favourite book. So you read it, and you enjoy it. But not as much as they did, because when they read it, it was in context of their knowledge of the rest of the series, the world it's set in, the characters that have built up over the course of that series, and so on. You might find yourself a little bit lost, because you lack the experience that they had when they read the book, and informed their understanding of it. And that's exactly what happened to me. And I mean, this was in the 90s, when there were not quite as many Discworld books as there are now. So rather than saying that you can read, you know, this series, and that series, and that series, people then used to just say, you know, the equivalent was, you just read them in any order, it doesn't really matter, they all stand alone. And I went with that, and I believed it. And it's true, I'm not saying it's not true, but what I am saying is that the fact that I believed this is the reason I've never been able to really get into Discworld. Now, I did enjoy the ones that I read. One of them was Reaper Man. I don't really remember much about that except the death of rats. I read Sorcery. I must have been 15 when I read Sorcery. And I loved it! And I loved it in ways that were really important to me. Because the thing about Terry Pratchett is, there's two things going on in any given Discworld book. I just need to get the milk. There's two things going on in Discworld books. There's two Discworlds, really. There's the one that Pratchett probably intended to make when he started out, and then there's the one that he maybe accidentally made. Just gotta go and put the milk back out. The Discworld that I think Pratchett set out to create was one of pure parody. Back then, I guess there were a lot of fantasy authors who really were sort of riding the Tolkien wave still. The whole fantasy genre had sprung up around the success of The Lord of the Rings, and of course you had Dungeons and Dragons and things like that, kind of codifying fantasy and making it into a particular set of ideas. And Discworld, the early Discworld books anyway, parody that, and that's kind of what they're for. I wish I knew what word I'm looking for that describes what I want to say Discworld isn't. You know, okay, think about Tolkien, right? So you've got the hobbits. They are kind of an exaggerated version of folksy fun. You know, they're all about breakfast and inns and songs and drinking and smoking and things like that, and just sort of generally having a knockabout time. And then you get to the elves, and the elves have this otherworldly way of being, and they stand tall and look out into the middle distance and speak with a lot of thee and thou. And that attitude is what I'm trying to find a word to describe, because even though Lord of the Rings has hobbits and elves, it's the elves that seem to have stuck with us as the de facto way of talking in fantasy things. You know, the modern equivalent to sort of pulpy, dodgy fantasy novels a few decades ago would be games, won't it? All of the fantasy RPGs that we play and so on. And in those, you do find that there are so many people who, even if they don't speak in the these and thous, they have that far away, look into the distance way of talking, that stunted dialogue. And it's not just on the elves, it goes all the way down to sort of the lowliest soldiers. And yes, they'll put some dialogue in their mouths about beer and women that tries to sort of make them seem a bit rowdy and humanize them a bit. But underneath all of that, there'll always be this current of stunted dialogue and peering out into the distant depths of the forest. Guardsmen with a helmet and a sword and shield, they're the equivalent of, you know, bouncers or security people. And when have you ever met one of those? Whoever says things like, my blade hungers for battle. But it's the sort of thing you expect them to say all the time in sort of dodgy fantasy things. Well, one of the main tools in Pratchett's toolbox, at least in the early days of Discworld, is to parody that. He'll take the same people, the soldiers, but also the wizards and the elves and all of it, and he'll have them talk in a completely down-to-earth, human-y sort of way. And sometimes they'll feel the urge to start talking in those kind of fantasy tones, and then they'll realise how silly it is and they'll stop. And that's a good joke, you know, that works the first few times, and then soon you've read it and you get the joke, okay. And then he'll bring in things like the actual characters that you tend to meet, and he'll parody those. So in the first book...
Second book, yes, thanks, shush.
You've got the heroic barbarian character, except he's really old, and it's what happens if his legend was actually several decades in the past, but he's still around and he's still trying to be a barbarian, but he's this frail old man now. Things like that. And that's the Discworld that I think he set out to create. But then there's a second Discworld, and this is the one that the fans, including myself, have latched onto. Because the fact of the matter is, just because of the kind of writer Terry Pratchett is and the kind of way that he thinks, along the way, he created a genuinely involving world. And it will just stay with you forever, and you'll want to keep going back to it. And that's where Discworld fandom comes from. That's why we've all got these books. You do want to go back there. It's the fans of that Discworld, the one that has built up over the years as we've settled into Pratchett's writing style and he's developed the places and he's developed the characters. That world is what the fans are fans of, and they want you to experience it. And so they want you to skip through the early books where it was more of a throwaway joke in order to get really into the sort of the meat of the series. And that makes perfect sense, doesn't it? But for me, it just didn't work. I decided at some point when I was a teenager that it was about time I got into reading Discworld. And there were about 20 Discworld books at that time, and me being a teenager, that meant that they felt as if they stretched back into all of history, and there was essentially no point in trying to read them all, because that was just too many books, and it didn't feel like that was what you were supposed to do anyway. So I thought I'd just sort of pick up wherever we happened to be, because remember, I'd fallen for that idea that you can just read Discworld books in any order, and I would go from there. And so, for Christmas, or my birthday, or whatever it was that year, I got the latest Discworld book. I think, I'm not totally sure on this, I think it was Feet of Clay. I tried to read Feet of Clay, and I couldn't. I just didn't know what was going on. I think I got to maybe a third of the way in or something, and there was soldier guys and someone getting hit by an arrow, but I don't know. I couldn't tell what was going on. I really couldn't. And it was then that the seed of the idea that eventually led to me reading the Discworld books successfully, which I'm now doing and I'm going to make videos about, began. Because maybe you can read these books, you know, divided into series or in any order you want or whatever, but I couldn't. It didn't work for me. And the reason for that is that this is an actual series of books that was chronologically written by one writer, and so naturally, his style develops, his ideas about what the series is develops, his ideas about Discworld develops, and the characters develop. And that is so much more approachable to me than trying to read in some kind of fan-created order. It's like if you tried to read the Narnia books chronologically instead of in the order that they were written. It works, but only if you already know them. So I thought, never mind the fact that the first few books are supposedly the weaker ones, I'm just going to read them anyway. And you know what? I was really pleasantly surprised.
And if you'd like to hear about what it was like to experience the series from the start, you can click the thing on the screen now to go to part two of this definitely intended to be two-part video and not one video that was just preposterously long at all, definitely!
Because it belongs to Two Flower, who is a brand new version of VLC,